facsimile to Figure 7, other than to make fun of it, which is too bad. It is a phenomenal symbol. Nibley notes that Min, of course, goes to Koptos. The most impressive thing about Min of Koptos is the manifest antiquity of everything about him and the immense age and conservatism of his cult. All down through history, Min insists on showing up at the national celebrations like some fossil intrusion from the beginning of time. This is on page 557 in his book Abraham in Egypt. Min is very important as the true mother of Min. I'll put it this way. The true mother of Min is the queen of the East. So we're talking royalty as well as a deity. The venerated Bedouin woman of legendary times, whose role could be played in the rites only by the wife of the pharaoh in person. Min's name was written heraldically, exactly like the lady's, with two crossed arrows, or the double-headed arrow, the classic thunderstone or lightning symbol, which marks Min as the great storm god. He is identified with Ammon Zeus. The name of Ammon is derived from Min as opener of the rain cloud, the god above the clouds. It's very interesting how he is a storm god and how this ties in to Yahweh in the Old Testament. One of the arguments is this cannot possibly have anything to do with a true Christian would not possibly find any of this important or influential or interesting. And yet the parallels, the ideas with Yahweh, which G.A. Wainwright brings out in extensive detail, which I will get into, show otherwise. The original settler of the land is what Min was. He is a true Adam figure. All living things proceed not from him, but from his eye, the woman. Min the Koptite, great god in the midst of the delightful trees, having dominion in the garden, who created the tree of life, who came forth from or created vegetation, who caused the flocks and herds to live. This is on page 558 of Nibley's Abraham in Egypt. So he is a very important figure. His first and highest calling is of the archetype and parent of all the kings of Egypt, all the former kings of the land. Line up on the right hand and on the left hand of Pharaoh as he offers sacrifices and sings hymns of praise to his father, Min. Together, the rites celebrate the beginning of a new life cycle, the beginning of the race, and the founding of the nation. This is so important. As the king goes to the dwelling of his father, Min, to celebrate a million jubilees and hundreds of thousands of years on his throne. That's on page 559. Very interesting. The name Min derives from Ammon, of course. Very good Book of Mormon name. Min, Men, Menu, and Ammon are all forms of the same name. That's on page 560. The first act of the king on going forth, this is the king, the new king on the throne, he is to shoot an arrow into each of the four cardinal points of the compass, signifying his rulership of the entire land, of course, the four quarters of the earth. Very important to the Egyptians. As early as the pyramid texts, which are some of the earliest texts, the Shabako stone, I believe, is earlier, but in the pyramid texts, we read of the king riding the four birds in the manner of Abraham's Nimrod, which Nimrod also shot the four arrows and claimed to be the ruler of the world. That's on page 560 and page 564 of Abraham in Egypt. Nibley shows also that the freestanding image of a god stood in the canonical hut at Koptos. It became the stock figure of the fruitful Ammon with upraised arm found on the temple walls all over Egypt, with the idea of proclaiming the king's reproductive office. His title of Min, who embraced the Wedjot Eye, makes him both husband and son of the lady. Very interesting that, in relation to Figure 7. Min is associated with the Wedjot Eye. That's on page 574. When we get to page 576, the whip that Min garnishes, he holds it with his upraised arm. This is always viewed as a fertility symbol. And Nibley says, compare the Lupercalia. And that is true. It always has to do with fertility, with fertilization, with progeny, fatherhood, godhood, etc. The abundance of life, that's the idea. See, the Egyptians viewed all life, all nature, time, the cosmos itself, as cyclical. They didn't have the concept of a linear time. They viewed it strictly as a cyclical aspect. And Min was also a beekeeper, as Nibley showed in chapter 12, in his chapter on the Deseret connection. He was a beekeeper, as was the lady Neith in Egypt. And the bees are very important for the idea of honey, the land flowing with milk and honey, abundance, fertility, resurrection. He who belongs to the bee, the Biti, the descendants of the royal bee were given this name, Biti. This is on page 610 of Nibley's Abraham in Egypt. He who belongs to the bee, the descendant of the bee, likewise the bee symbol of Min equals Horus. This does not tell us that Min is a bee, but that Min is he who belongs to the bee, who stands in relation to the bee. See, the succession to the crown is assured when Horus marries the queen bee and takes over the land. And this is interestingly symbolized in our figure 7 with that Horus costume that Min is wearing, the tail and the wings of the hawk that is on his back. Nibley shows in extensive details, page 621, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, the principle, the idea of the bee as symbolic of the power, the beauty, the use of the resurrection. The implication being eternal life. And it always occurred, of course, in a sacred garden setting. Well, the garden, the Hermetic doctrine, as above, so below, we could potentially, possibly see the hypocephalus itself. Granted, yes, it is a cosmological map, but it could be the heavenly garden, because Earth was originally formed as, yeah, the earthly paradise, the earthly garden. Same thing with facsimile number 3, or number 2, I mean. Facsimile number 3 is a different thing, which I will mention. See, when we go to G.A. Wainwright in his 1937 study, The Sky Religion in Egypt, on page 9, he says his studies of the sky religion has shown that the deities go back way back in ancient times, so much in fact that they became lost and shadowy figures, and they appear to us as little more than names. He says the Egyptologist Junker has recently shown that there had been a nameless sky god who was already fusing in proto-dynastic times with the Hawk god to form a compound deity, namely Horus.